Well, welcome everybody to our session today on behavioral economics and social movements. We are delighted to have Professor Cass Sunstein with us from Harvard Law School, a behavior economics expert, former Obama administration official. And we'll be going to, we're going to talk for a little bit and then we'll go to questions in about a half an hour. So we're very much interested in your involvement in the discussion as well. I do want to say the symposium is presented by the Maurice Greenberg Center for Geoeconomic Studies. It's made possible through the generous support of the Robert B. Menschel Fund. So thank you all for joining us. It's on the record. And if you wouldn't mind just putting your cell phones on stun mode so they don't ring through during the session. Excellent. Cass, thanks for joining us. Delighted that you're here. You've just written a book, How Do We Change? How Does Social Change Actually Happen? And it focuses a lot on social norms. And I'm wondering if we can start by just understanding what exactly is a social norm?
It's a regularity whose violation triggers social disapproval. So if I were wearing a t-shirt and it said Tom Brady forever, that would violate, I do have such a t-shirt, but wearing it would be a violation of social norms. Or if right now I lit up a cigarette, that would be a violation of social norms. Or if someone said something that violated widespread evaluation of what it's appropriate to say, such that there'd be a kind of taboo triggered, then we'd know a social norm was at risk.
So we all like to think of ourselves as individually minded. We come to this session and any other interaction with preconceived notions. We behave in certain ways. But there are forces that can cause us to change those preconceived notions and behave in new ways. Can you describe some of those forces?
Sure. So if you think of things like buckling your seatbelts or smoking cigarettes or making certain remarks about gender or sexual orientation or making certain remarks about immigrants, these have all gone very different ways over a relatively short time. A social norm is sometimes the equivalent of a tax or a subsidy, so that if you violate it, you're like you're taxed stiffly. If you say something, you know, that's inconsistent with social norms with respect to something people widely believe about religion, then you're going to be hit hard in terms of how other people react. And the sign, whether it's a positive or negative, can shift over a decade. So there are acts and statements that used to be subsidized that are now taxed, and exactly the opposite. So there was a time when buckling a seatbelt was like a suggestion, I think you're a bad driver, or I'm a really cowardly person who's terrified by life. That's the norm was such that buckling your seatbelt was such a signal, and it still is in some parts of the world. Now, buckling your seatbelt has no accusation of the driver or confession of being afraid. And so the tax has been taken away. And these shift very dramatically. And we often find ourselves acting in accordance with a norm, even if it shifted, like yesterday, without being very self-conscious about it. It happens so unconsciously and rapidly that our own reflectiveness about our change might be, you know, really fast. And then you think, oh, this is what people do.
Nothing like going through a windshield to maybe change the notion of the importance of buckling your seatbelt. How does the Me Too movement factor into what you just described? How do those forces play out in what we have seen happen with the Me Too movement?
In some parts of many countries, what was neutral, meaning it was socially neither taxed nor subsidized, let's call it mildly harassing behavior or worse, has now been accompanied by a stiff tax. And the word tax, you know, just means there's a negative association such that to do it is to expose oneself as a bad actor, which is a qualitatively distinctive kind of tax. And so what hashtag MeToo has done in some places is to make things that range from the offensive to the horrific and to turn them taboo where formerly, at least in some places, they weren't. They were in some places, not places that I know well, I'm pleased to be able to say, but in some places, apparently, that kind of behavior was either fine or actually was rewarded as the kind of things that certain kind of men did, and it was a stamp of something good. And hashtag MeToo has, it's still a work in progress, but it's turned it either sideways, meaning you're no longer just supposed to do it, or upside down, such that doing it is regarded as what it actually is under law, either a civil or criminal offense.
So in your new book, How Change Happens, you talk about a phenomenon called the norm entrepreneur. Explain that for us.
Okay. So there are people, some of whom will never make it into the history books, others of whom have chapters devoted to them, who have sparked either a local or a global change in norms. They have, Rosa Parks was a norm entrepreneur. Adolf Hitler was a norm entrepreneur, where the thought is there is a widespread taboo associated with something or an absence of a taboo associated with something, and that has to shift. And the kind of brilliance of the most effective norm entrepreneurs, and I think on this count, Rosa Parks and Adolf Hitler, you know, had something in common. They were alert to the fact that inside people's heads were, let's call them moral commitments or something that people weren't actually articulating. So let's use the Rosa Parks one because it's easier, where what she was signaling is there are a lot of victims of, call it discrimination or oppression, who lived quietly with it but despised it. And what they needed was the equivalent of a green light by which their internal feeling of humiliation or outrage could be vocalized or turned into behavior. And her own bravery gave a green light to expression of what was inside a head. And it turned out that the number of people in whose heads that was really large. And at least white people didn't know that. Probably African Americans generally did, but probably they had less awareness of the intensity and widespreadness of it than emerged after the green light was given. And I'm giving a case of a civil rights, you know, incomplete but significant victory over the decades. In the Hitler case, it's, you know, the valence is different, but it has something not so different where what Hitler was able to do was to be able to give a green light to, you know, anti-Semitism of the most horrific sort. And one reason he was able to succeed is that there were not a lot, I hope, in terms of percentages, but sufficiently significant in terms of percentages, people who harbor those feelings inside, and they were taboo. And Hitler said, bring it on, it's okay. It's actually valid. And that led in a very rapid time to, you know, not a civil rights movement, but to a massive cultural shift. And the what the norm entrepreneur does is to identify a disconnect between people's beliefs and actions and their actual statements and conduct. And once their beliefs and actions privately are revealed to be different from what their beliefs and actions publicly are, there's an opening, there's a wedge. And that has led to some of the greatest advances. They can be really small but great, like politeness or opening doors for people whose legs don't work so good, or treating people with mental illness as people who are, you know, struggling with something that isn't in kind different from what is recognized as a struggle which society should help with, like you're blind or you can't hear. And sometimes the normal perturbator signals that, or something terrible can happen because the human heart, as George Lucas, author of Star Wars movies, knows, there's a dark side and there's a light side in all of us. And normal entrepreneurs can trigger one or the other.
So this is tapping into something that you call falsified preferences in your book, which is that we really don't know what people are thinking. We think that that we know because we're all kind of conforming to a conventional way of interacting, but they could be thinking something quite different. And this is kind of fertile turf for norm entrepreneurs to tap into and then change. In the case of Rosa Parks, she's an example of a norm entrepreneur that was an unintended spark. I mean, she says she was just tired that day and she had enough and she took a seat on the bus. In the case of and look what happened. In the case of Hitler, it was much more intended as a norm entrepreneur. So it could be either. It could be a norm entrepreneur that had no intention of being one.
Completely. I love what you say about Rosa Parks, which is historically true, that she wasn't intending to create a movement. And sometimes if you're really tired or, you know, something, you just do what you think best.
It's the vegetable vendor in Tunisia who kind of sparked the yeah, Arab Spring.
Completely. And so there are norm entrepreneurs, people who never make the history books, who are deliberately doing that. And they're in New York or Los Angeles or, you know, Columbus, Ohio today. And they're doing something which will lead to something major. Or there are people who are just saying, the norm, I don't like it. And I'm not going to speak as if I do.
So we're going to get into politics a bit more in your next session, but just to take take the obvious detour here for a second, Donald Trump tapped into this in 2016.
Yes, and his emphasis on political correctness is astute. So whether you think he's, you know, you're for him or against him, he's onto something which is deep, which is that in people's minds is often a sense that there is a norm which is crushing what they authentically think. And he's truthful about political correctness, that it does have a free speech quelling feature, political correctness of the left-wing sort. I'll tell you a little story which really got me able in my own head to put words on paper for this book. I was in a room it was had a lot of people in it, and one of whom was one of the world's great athletes. He's American. And I asked him a question I always wanted to ask one of the world's great athletes. There were about 10 of us in a little group in this room, about 300. And I said, suppose it's the end of the game, there are about 2 minutes left or less, and this guy's sufficiently good, so what I'm about to say isn't hypothetical. I said, it's all on you. The outcome's all on you. Said, in that moment when, you know, everyone's watching, it's all on you, are you having fun? And he responded, absolutely. That's what I was born for. I've been trained to do this. This is sport. This is sport at its most rich. You ask me, am I having fun? Of course, I love it. That really surprised me, I confess. So about an hour and 15 minutes later, I found myself with him, very tall. And I said, can we just go in a corner for a minute? And I took him into the corner of the room. And I said, your answer, I didn't expect that answer. Is that the truth? And he said, you want to know the truth? And I said, please. And he said, you asked me if I'm having fun in the last 2 minutes where everything turns on my performance? No. I said, I hate it. He said, don't get me wrong, I'm good at it. I'm trained for it. And he's famously great at it. He's a terrific clutch performer. He said, no, it's awful. And I thought, now I can write the book. Because he was obeying a norm, which is a great athlete doesn't hate performing under pressure. And notice I'm respecting his trust in me, because the reason he didn't say it in the group of 10 was they didn't want it in the newspaper. It might have affected a salary negotiation. It certainly would have been a blow to his reputation. But the disjunction between what he would say publicly and privately, Oh, and there's work now with respect to Saudi Arabia, where Saudi young Saudi men, if asked, do they want their wives to work outside of the home? They have had until recently maybe still veto power. Young Saudi men say, absolutely, that's fine with me. That's great. I would be just fine with my wife working outside of the home. And the data suggests the answer is more like, I want them to work outside of the home. We need the money. But then they're asked, what do other young Saudi men think? And they say, oh, the norm is people like me, I'm isolated, I'm the only one. My friends, they don't want their wives working outside of the home. The norm is very negative. Now, here's where things get cool. Half of the people in a very large group, half of the men were told, actually, you're wrong about the norm. If you ask people privately, the other young Saudi men agree with you. They think it's fine. And in that population, several months later, the number of women applying for work and actually ending up outside working outside of the home skyrocketed. It's now okay. It's now okay because it was revealed that the norm was consistent with their private beliefs. And that's a story of equality rising in a situation in which men believed in it, but didn't think it was okay.
And now other preferences take hold, marital harmony, the wife wants to work outside, and the extra income. So is social media speeding this process, this social change in general? Social change requires interaction. You're describing, you know, people communicating with each other, norm entrepreneurs, et cetera, and social media accelerates that interaction? Or does it do the reverse? Does it create insularity and a kind of an echo chamber of like-mindedness that keeps social change from happening?
It's a fantastic question. And we see a lot of both. So you mentioned hashtag MeToo, and its success was fueled by social media, where after Alyssa Milano said something, hashtag MeToo, she was the popularizer, 42% of American Facebook users had hashtag MeToo on their page within 24 hours. It went wild. And that was she was acting as a norm entrepreneur, in that case, deliberately, and she succeeded in giving the same kind of green light that the Saudi men had been given by the experimenters. But it's also the case that, let's call it political correctness as a red light to expressing what you actually think, is very much in play in social media, where if you find yourself in a group online of people who think X or Y or Z, it could be something about a product, it could be something about climate change, could be something about something involving equality, to buck the group online is to risk ostracism. And that can be, or worse, not just ostracism, but hatred and rage. And that can lead people to self-silence. And once you self-silence, it's very hard not to start quieting that very voice in your own head that you're no longer allowed to express publicly. So what is unthinkable in the sense that within the group, people don't say that, can eventually become unthought. That's the sometimes inspiring process, but more often, you know, dystopian science fiction process, where what's unthinkable, meaning socially sanctioned online, punished. Sanction is one of those not good words that means both itself and its opposite. So let's just say punished. What's punished online, sometimes among participants, and we're seeing this every day, becomes like a little tiny voice in one's head that one starts ignoring.
I get the sense in reading the book about, as much as we like to think that we're progressing, that human beings are pretty malleable, kind of like clay. And we can zig and we can zag where social change is concerned. You know, on the one hand, yeah, we have vaccines now for diseases, and we haven't had a major war in 75 years. But that can change pretty quickly. Or do you find that social change is progressive, that things get better?
So I have on my door in my office a quotation which I made into like a bumper sticker, which comes from Daniel Kahneman, who's been here, who in an interview not long ago kept asking what he thought, and he kept saying he didn't know. And the interviewer, this wasn't a very good interview, he kept saying, I don't know. The interviewer finally said, what do you think? And he said, it's not a matter of thinking, it's an empirical question. So I have on my door, it's not a matter of thinking, it's an empirical question. I originally made it as stated as a bumper sticker, but I'm too scared to put it on my car because I think I'll get stopped, right? what's he doing?
Stop and frisk.
Who is this guy? Stop and frisk. What does that even mean? So the question whether there's progress, I'm hearing Kahneman's words in my mind. And a couple of thoughts. One is, I think Steven Pinker convincingly shows that along multiple measures, things are just getting better and better. So people are living longer, there's less war, there's less killing, there's better health, et cetera. A lot of it's through technological improvements, but a lot of it's through, let's call it civilization in the large, where we see each other as fellow members of the species and don't them as much as people did. So there's that. But I think your point is right, that to see the arc of history as bending toward justice has complacency in it. Mm. And given the fact that forgive the reference to George Lucas, one of my heroes, but what makes Star Wars great, one of the many things that makes it great is its alertness to the dark side of the human soul. And it's connected with tribalism and with feelings inside of humiliation. And if those are triggered, then things can go very bad, especially, but not only, if people are facing economic or other woes. And in some parts of the world, we're definitely seeing that.
There is, and it comes through in your book also, there is a kind of a herd-like instinct to human beings. I mean, 300,000 years of product development has kind of shown us it pays to stick with a group, that it's safer from a survival standpoint. You don't want to get, as you said earlier, ostracized. You don't want to get thrown out of the cave. And that lends itself to manipulation.
Let me tell you a little experiment I did in Colorado a few years ago, not that long ago. I went to Boulder with colleagues and got a bunch of people who were screened, so we made sure they were left of center people. The reason we did that was only for purpose of the experiment. And we asked them privately what they thought about climate change, whether they thought there should be something like a Paris Agreement and how much they believed in that. And then we had them deliberate as a group to a verdict, and then we recorded their views anonymously. We did the same thing in Colorado Springs, which is right of center, and we screened them to make sure they were actually right of center. Okay, here's what happened. It's exactly what you say, and I've seen the tapes, so you can see it happening in real time. Before people talk to each other, the people in Boulder, I'm going to put right somewhat to my left on climate change, they wanted an agreement, but they showed some diversity there, and there were some people who weren't sure an international agreement was a good idea. In Colorado Springs, I'm putting this somewhat to my right, they were not in favor on average of an international agreement, but some of them were, and they had varying degrees of concern about climate change, meaning not they were all unconcerned. After they talked to one another, the people in Boulder went whoosh to the left. They became unified, confident, and extreme. The people in Colorado Springs, after half an hour of conversation, reaching a verdict, in their anonymous statements of view post-deliberation, they went whoosh to the right. They were thinking climate change is a hoax, an international agreement is a terrible idea, and they thought that basically unanimously. before they talked just with one another, they were about this far apart, you know, significant, but not different universes. After they talked to each other, they were this far apart. And we could see in real time one of the things that was happening, which was the people in Colorado Springs who thought, you know, I'm a little worried about climate change. It seems like it's getting hot. They didn't want to say that in front of a group whose majority would think that they were ridiculous or traitors. And in Boulder, it was exactly parallel. There are some people you could see starting to say, how much is this agreement going to cost us? And what are we going to get from it? But then they started looking around thinking, oh, man, if I talk in those terms, it's going to be the rest of the meeting isn't going to go well for me. And the idea is this is a tiny little experiment, but it's happening, you know, in real time right now. Not like an hour from now or an hour ago. It's happening right now, where either online or in private groups, people who are discussing any number of issues, like whether a product's going to succeed or whether on issue X some candidate has it right, it's like the Boulder experiment.
We're going to come to your questions in just a minute. But a bit in this context, in the book you also studied what you call partyism. It's very relevant to today's world in the United States. Tell us what you discovered.
So what appears true is that along some dimensions, automatic revulsion toward people of the opposing political party is crushing racism. In a way, that's a great achievement, that racism is falling according to what we can record. But if people are asked in 40 years ago, what would you think if your child married a Republican? Say, great, that's fine by me. Be a weirdo 40 years ago who'd say that's a problem. Now, latest evidence we have, something like 35% of Republicans would be very upset if their child married a Democrat, and about the same number of Democrats would be very upset if their child married a Republican. Don't want your child to marry one. And the numbers are increasing dramatically over time. People will discriminate in their hiring choices. I'll hire someone of the same political party as I am in, even if they're less qualified than the other person, when they wouldn't discriminate on the basis of sex or race. And I saw it in Washington where, you know, to identify yourself as a member of one or another party was to make someone's face fall if they were a different one. And that this is recognizable, isn't it? And it didn't used to be like this. And in other countries in which this phenomenon has been studied, it hasn't been picked up. It seems to be a distinctly American phenomenon. And I think it's connected with the Boulder and Colorado Springs experiment. It makes productive action, let's say on infrastructure, hard if you think that you're maybe dealing with someone whom you'd be aghast at your child marrying.
And it's become that way because why?
Well, we don't know exactly why. Social media seems to be a contributor. So your point about like-minded people living in echo chambers, that seems to have helped fuel it.
And your choice of news channel.
And your choice of news channel, where if you can select your communications universe, you can end up in a cocoon, like our Boulder experiment. You could end up, that's how you live. And if you're my climate change experimental subjects, after their conversation, they were not liking their fellow citizens in Colorado Springs who thought the opposite. They were thinking they were horrible people, whereas before they were thinking they had a disagreement. And in campaigns, it gets worse because of negative campaigning. And you can see this. Right, with negative campaigning, people become so sharply identified with the person they like that the opposing person is not just wrong or foolish, but is some kind of demon. And whatever you think of politics today, think of this as a pervasive thing in politics over the last 12 years or so in the United States. Can I tell you one thing that this makes me bullish on? This isn't the happiest picture, is that there are people working every day in the US government, in the Department of Transportation, working on issues of highway safety, in the Department of Agriculture, working on food safety, who to try to figure out whether they're a Democrat or Republican is really hard.
Hard to do.
And even to ask them, they tell you, but they'd wonder why, and it wouldn't be central to their self-understanding.
Well, you do end that chapter kind of on this attempt at optimism, where you say, and it's spoken like a former bureaucrat, I gotta say, that what we need to do is have more reliance on technocratic expertise is the term you chose. And you had a very important role in the Obama administration in the Office of Regulation and kind of oversight. So that to me sounds like technocratic expertise. That sounds to me like a reliance on what we do think moderates this polarization, which is the rule of law and institutions. You mentioned Agriculture Department, State Department, et cetera. And yet, I think what we're seeing of late is that the rule of law and institutions in this country can be quite fragile.
Yeah, okay, so here's my association as you talk. In the next 24 hours, everyone in this room is going to benefit from and demonstrate norms of considerateness with respect to strangers on the street. You will do things and be benefit. I just noticed this coming in from the train, that these people, you know, let me find my way with my bag or held the door for me, or when I was talking on the phone, were quiet. And I tried to do the same. And these norms of considerateness from which we are mutually gaining are so part of the fabric of a day that we don't even notice we're doing them. And governance can be like this, true, yeah, certainly workplace life, families, but if they start to collapse, then there's a big problem. And if the, you know, there's no banner that says technocracy now, or if there were, that would be a norm violation. Okay, I'm going to make a bumper sticker to that effect and put it in my closet so even I can't find it. But if the, and basically I think the picture in our government for all the, you know, challenges, it's by world historical standards fantastically good. We can eat food or drink water, and the chance that it's clean is very high and safe. The likelihood of 5,000 Americans die in workplace accidents, that's much too many, but considering the size of our country, that's a great achievement. And part of it is the private sector working really hard to make sure people don't get hurt. Part of it is spreading best practices. Part of it is the Occupational Safety and Health Administration and the state equivalents. But when norms are shaken, either in individual life or in, you know, at a company or in government, then there's hell to pay. Either restoration of a new norm or some sort of law instead of a norm, that's what's needed.
Let's go to your questions. And if I can just remind you, it's on the record, if you could tell us who you are, and if you can keep your questions short so we can get to as many of you as possible. Bob Hormats, right here in the front.
Thanks very much.
We're gonna get a microphone to you.
Thanks very much. I enjoyed very much our association in the Obama administration. I'm glad you're writing and thinking about this. One question, particularly in the current political environment, that troubles me, and I suspect it troubles you and many in the room, is the salience of the issue not simply of race, which is a deep traditional issue in this country and still not one fully resolved, but to broaden that, the us versus them, the sort of xenophobic, anti-immigrant, particularly anti-immigrants of color, different nationalities, different races. How most people probably, at least in parts of the country we travel in, would on the face of it say, oh no, we don't pay any attention to that. So the question is, in general, how deeply held are those kinds of things that have come up in American politics, particularly in the current administration, and how regional is it? Because if you go to the tribal issue that John mentioned, you can the tribal views on some of these things might be different in the tribe seated around this room and an equivalent group in, say, Des Moines or some other part of the country. So I'd be interested if you could sort of dig deep. How deep is this problem, or how pervasive is it, and how regional is it?
Okay, I'll give you the only data I have, and then I'll speculate a little bit.
Okay.
So here's the only data I have. There was a study done relatively recently in which people were asked, do you want to give to a xenophobic organization, anti-immigrant organization? And they were given an opportunity to do it anonymously or in a way that was publicly knowable. And these were large groups of people, so it was a randomized experiment. And not amazingly, a lot more people would give anonymously than would give publicly. There was a very significant disparity, which suggests it's like my athlete, that people wouldn't want people to know. Then, and here's where things get interesting, people were reminded that Trump is the president. Just as part of a different version of the experiment, they were just told, no, the president, Trump is the president. Then the difference between the anonymous and the public disappeared, went to zero, because people thought it's okay. I'm not gonna get in trouble. President is basically broadly in my corner on these issues. This was not geographical, but it does suggest, this was, as I recall, this wasn't geographically, it didn't tell us a lot about the geographic distribution, but it did show there are a number of people who privately harbor anti-immigrant sentiments who are willing to give voice to them only if they know it's okay socially. I have a different hunch, though, broadly, and this is speculative, which is that in the average American's mental orbit, on a given day, anti-immigrant sentiment is not swirling around. It's like, how's my kid doing? How's my job going? How are my parents? You know, do I have anyone to date? That sort of thing. Not immigrants, immigrants, immigrants. So the idea here, which is a great question, it suggests something we haven't explored yet, is sometimes social change happens when some people are being given a license to say what's in their heads. But sometimes there's a transformation where something is made salient or activated, which wasn't there before. And if you look at issues involving, let's say, sex equality, at least among a lot of men, probably a lot of women over the years, it wasn't like something suppressed came out. It was just there was a transformation in people's understanding of what society should look like. And I think with immigrants, a lot of it has been a norm entrepreneur who hasn't given the green light to people to say what they secretly thought, but who said, you should be worried about this. And given, you know, the way the human mind works, if you have stories of violence or of job displacement, you can activate people. Now, whether people, I want to be very careful not to say that people in some parts of the union are more easily activated than people in other parts of the union, because I think anything I would say, A, would have a high chance of being wrong, and B, have a very high chance of playing to a stereotype that wouldn't be very nice to play to. So I'm going to be careful about that.
So it can be inculcated. Yes, right here in the back. Yes, you. Can we get a microphone right here? Just a reminder, tell us who you are and who you're with.
Miriam Zafi, I'm a CFR term member. What role do you think unearned privilege plays in the ability of a norm entrepreneur to succeed? And I'm specifically thinking when the discussions around Me Too, there was no mention of Tarana Burke, who started it over a decade ago. And when we talked about Rosa Parks, she was characterized as tired. And in her own autobiography, she states that she wasn't, you know, tired or old. She was 42 years old. And in fact, it was very strategic. She was a seasoned activist. So I guess my question is sort of these other structural, if you could overlay an intersectional analysis.
Okay, I should say.
Very different history.
I should say about Rosa Parks. I'm no expert on her psychological state. So take this as a placeholder for two different types: people who say I've had enough, and people who are deliberately trying to engineer something. And they're both really interesting. I'm not sure what you mean by unearned privilege. So this is just a semantic question.
The stage that Me Too really took off in a viral state, whereas Tarana Burke, who was African American, who started it over a decade ago, it just didn't pick up. So that's the
okay.
The term.
So I hear you. So what kind of activist ends up having what kind of impact turns on 1,001 different things, and it might be that there's a benefit by being, you know, white. Or male or not. So in some domains, the fact that a person is, let's say, relatively poor and a person of color is a comparative advantage for being a norm entrepreneur, because there's a signal of something that is accompanied by those characteristics. If you're a famous actor or actress, then you have a megaphone. And it might be that Taylor Swift, who's one of my favorites, she's white and female, and gosh, does she have a megaphone. So I'm puzzling now I'll tell you my general understanding of social life, that there's a lot more serendipity than the human mind naturally sees. So whether it's Alyssa Milano or Rosa Parks or Martin Luther King or Robert Kennedy, there's a lot of serendipity in who goes where and when and who becomes that. So that's my kind of pathetically incomplete answer.
Let's get it right here in the front. Then I'll come to you in the back.
Thank you.
I'll come to you next.
Philip Ellison, Grapevine Development. Professor Sunstein, given the American system of representative democracy and the, you know, versus majoritarianism, and given the enumerated individual rights of the Constitution, not just the first 10 amendments, but, you know, through the entire document, there seems to be a trend, I think maybe you put your finger on it, about, you know, a kind of a conformity, that we're kind of almost reliving the 1950s, that there's a conformity being demanded by social norms, whether you're in a blue state or a red state, and those groups you point out in Colorado. I'm curious if any of that conformity, and again, the whole debate about the Electoral College and everything else, and majority rules and all of those things, if we're in danger of endangering those human rights in the Constitution by criminalizing, not literally, but in some cases literally criminalizing, deviations from social norms.
Okay. The particular thing that I think you're putting your finger on is probably best described as tribalism. And here's a funny experiment, which takes an assortment of political issues. They're not extremely familiar in the sense that people wouldn't know, you know, it's guns, where if it's gun control, you might know what you think, given your beliefs or your tribal affiliation. It's more like nanotechnology or something. And in the experiment, people were sorted into, without knowing, they were sorted into groups where they could see online what other people thought. And they could see the political affiliation of the people who were in their large online group. So they could see on nanotechnology, oh, most Republicans like it, or most Democrats like it. And the basic upshot is that in online opinion, people could be shifted very dramatically. Republicans could all go, yay, and Democrats could all go, boo, or the opposite, depending on whether the initial Democrats or the initial Republicans seem to go yay or boo. Meaning, you could establish an equilibrium where nanotechnology was something Republicans loved and Democrats hated, or vice versa, depending on who initially seemed to like it. You get the craziness of this? And I think we're observing that in real time, where at least on a wide assortment of issues, what Republicans and Democrats like is a reflection of what prominent early movers seem to like. Not all issues, but a lot of issues. Immigration is probably one, yes? Okay, so on the Bill of Rights, I'm struggling a little bit on that because I'm thinking about literal violations of the Bill of Rights, religious liberty, freedom of speech, freedom from unreasonable searches and seizures, the Due Process Clause, protection against takings of private property without just compensation. And I'm pondering what you have exactly in mind with criminalization that offends one of those things. So I guess I'm pleased to say my mind's drawing a bit of a blank, which is not ordinarily a pleasant emotional state to be in. But on this one, so what do you have in mind where criminalization is offending one of the...
I guess I'm thinking really of you know, free speech questions, you know, that I mean, and there are many others that would be related. I mean, of course, if you violate a free speech or a public norm, you know, in terms of your speech, we now seem to be in a place where a lot of things have become actual criminal offenses that, you know,
such as,
well, New York City now, it's a crime to make a comment on someone's hairstyle. You know, it's...
I, given my state, I have some sympathy for that.
You know, I mean, but these are things that, you know, of course they probably aren't going to be enforced very heavily, but and I think there are a couple of cases pending you know, kind of waiting the Supreme Court's action on free speech grounds. But that's maybe just the tipping point where speech, and then of course, you know, taking one's property because of things you've said or done in public. You know, I'm just curious that we do seem to be taking things very literally and criminalizing a lot of behaviors that used to be left to the individual or his or her group to enforce.
Okay, I agree with the values you're expressing. In fact, I think the values you're expressing, if anything's bedrock for a democracy, is what he said. But I'm not thinking that it's much at risk. So the Supreme Court, so far as I'm aware, has no cases. And this might just be a gap in my knowledge, but no cases where this sort of thing is there. I hope we don't get there. One area where I think we are doesn't involve criminalization, but involve norms, where people are afraid to say things that may be a very important part of public discussion, or maybe a legitimate part of public discussion, even if it's rightly viewed as abhorrent.
Speakers getting shut down on campuses.
Completely. And, you know, at some universities like the one I'm lucky enough to teach at, there are students with certain political views who are silencing themselves because they think it's not acceptable. And I'm thinking of people who are on the conservative side, and that's doesn't matter really. That's antithetical for your reason. So it might be that in terms of the real world of freedom of speech, and I saw this in the Boulder and Colorado Springs tapes, people were being silenced, not because other people were saying, you say that, I'm going to hate you, but because there was a fear of that and because people didn't want to incur that. So to create a culture of receptivity to either individual participants in the discussion or people who are in leadership roles is completely essential. And so I'm working myself a little bit up very much in your direction that both, you know, in Colorado Springs and Boulder, let's have them placeholders for left and right. There are aggressive norms that make it so the professional athlete and equivalents will say, I'm having a lot of fun here with 1 minute to go and it's all on my shoulders.
Way in the back there, yes, in the pink.
Mary Lake Pohl in Yale University. I think your experiment in Colorado is very intriguing. But let's push that one step farther. Let's take that to a hypothetical Democrat and Republican rally before you go to vote. What happens when people go into a voting booth privately? Do they behave the way your tall, perhaps basketball athlete did, and they say what they believe? Or do they adhere to the herd instinct? And do you have data on that?
I don't. It's a great question. So let me talk around it a little bit and just give you a change-related data point, which doesn't answer your question, but is relevant to it. You may know about this. Work done on the Chinese government's relationship to its own social media uncovers what to me is a big surprise, which at least up until recently, and I have no reason to believe this isn't still the case, there's a lot of dissent on social media in China, and the government doesn't do anything about it in the sense of censoring. So if people go on social media and Twitter and say negative things about the government, what the government will typically do is flood the system with positive things, saying, you know, things are going great here along just the dimension along which people are dissenting, but will not take down or suppress the dissenter. By contrast, if someone says, we're having a meeting on this street in Beijing on Thursday at 4 in the afternoon, please come, that is taken down. And the person who puts that up is at risk. I think there's acuteness in this behavior, that what the person who says, we're meeting at 4 o'clock, on this road, they're creating the Boulder experiment. They're creating a group of people, and that's dangerous. That can stir up confidence, unity, and relative extremism, and the government's nervous about that. Okay, in terms of the anonymous voting behavior, the trick in our Colorado experiment is that what my co-authors, I think, were principally interested in is what's the verdict? How does the verdict compare, the group's verdict, compare to the anonymous views they stated before they speak? And the verdict is consistent with what was just described. That is, the verdict is unified and extreme compared to the anonymous statements. But what I was interested in was the anonymous statements after the verdict. The anonymous statements are extreme and unified. They track the verdict. So people go in the group, they adhere to the group, and then anonymously, under conditions where their privacy is guaranteed, they're with the group. Now, what's going on there? I think it's either that they've actually been persuaded, or it's that having been part of a process, let's say it's a rally, where you get all excited in one way or another by people like you, then to go privately in the voting booth and do something else, you feel like a creep or an idiot. And so our little experiment kind of tracked anonymous voting, and it found that what people ended up with publicly in terms of their consensus with the group is almost exactly where they were privately afterwards. So that's the hunch. It is, though, the consistent with Kahneman's precept, want to think of it as an empirical question, and it can be good if people are in an inspiring rally, let's say, and they're convinced that the direction of the candidate, it's great. You know, I worked on the Obama campaign in 2008, and I saw that. And I confess, I like President Obama, and whichever candidate you like, Republican or Democrat, there can be learning and consensus, and so it's not only a negative.
Question right over here.
Hi, Rick Stengel, MSNBC. Hi, Cass. How are you? Congratulations on the book. You talked about norms of considerateness, like someone opening the door for you if you have a bag. That's wonderful. I wouldn't legislate that that has to be done. That's a norm that's acceptable. But one of the things we're finding, I believe, in the current administration is that things that were considered norms, like the President of the United States doesn't interfere in a Justice Department investigation, maybe it shouldn't just be a norm. Maybe it should be a statute. What are norms in government, and in your old job in government, you were looking at regulation. What are things that are norms in government that now you think, wow, those should be laws and be protected?
Right. So it's a fantastic question. And, you know, you could be an enthusiastic supporter of the president and be extremely nervous about a President Sanders and have exactly the question you're asking, where it might involve exercise of presidential power or it might involve socialism or something. And the question would be nonpartisanly insistent. So unless I dreamed it, I think I have an op-ed in the New York Times that went up 2 hours ago that's right on your question. And it supports a position that I would have thought preposterous as recently as 8 months ago. And it's right on what you say. So I'll tell you the proposition I would have thought preposterous, which is that the Department of Justice should be an independent agency like the Federal Reserve Board or the Federal Communications Commission. And let me talk a little bit about the Federal Reserve Board and the Federal Communications Commission. They've long been independent of the president, and Democrats and Republicans and independents have all agreed on that as a broad principle, even if they've thought the Fed and the Federal Communications Commission are terrible, on the ground that for the president to oversee an agency that's deciding who gets licenses, you know, TV and radio, that there's, even if the risk of politicization is low, it's intolerable. So the FCC gets to be an independent agency. Federal Reserve Board, Democrat or Republican president has a high temptation in election year to juice the economy and lower the interest rates, so it's an independent agency. And seems to be general agreement. Now let's think about the Department of Justice. It has the authority both to undertake and to refuse to undertake criminal prosecutions. Probably the cautious word would be that's awesome power. The better word is it's terrifying power. Anyone in this room could be subject to an investigation, which could ruin your wallet, or possibly an indictment, which could, you know, for a time or maybe longer, ruin your life. And the Justice Department gets to do that. Now, if there's a president, you know, of any political party who gets in his or her mind, you know, we got to do something about this, once, then our country's transformed. Or if the president maybe once or twice says, we're not going to go after our friends, that then the incentive to be a friend is skyrocketing. And yes, for both friends and enemies. And that suggests that the argument in principle for making the Department of Justice independent of the president, and this was something that's been thought of at times by both Democratic and Republican presidents, President Carter considered this very seriously. After the Watergate affair, both Democrats and Republicans were thinking about this. Now, if you have a norm in place that is very robust, that says there won't be political interference, I'll tell you something from my own experience, shall I? Which is that I was privileged to oversee regulation. There was one time when a member of the cabinet said, you know, you should consider issuing this regulation because it's in the president's political interest. I was on a phone call, and I said to the cabinet member, you and I have never discussed politics in terms of issuing regulations, and please let's not start now. And the cabinet head laughed and said, you're absolutely right. The cabinet head was violating a taboo, which you don't issue a regulation involving the environment or food or occupational safety because you're going to swing a state to the president. And I can't tell you how horrifying that thought is to me. You can't do that. And if the government were doing things like that, let's say on a regular basis, then there'd need to be institutional change because the norm collapsed, which is a long way of saying that the, for a law professor, the radical and crazy idea of putting some distance between any president and the law enforcement agency of the federal government, it has logic. And it's not unfamiliar. In the states, the attorney general is not dischargeable at the will of the governor. And if it were suggested the attorney general should be, in multiple states, dischargeable at the will of the governor, there'd be an uprising. People would say, what? The attorney general has a duty to the rule of law. And even governors, you know, accept or celebrate that, saying, don't put that on me. Then you put me in a terrible position. So you're making a deep point, and to think of the long term rather than, you know, President Sanders, President Trump, President Obama, President Bush, that gives us a veil of ignorance behind which we can maybe make institutional changes that are suited to norms which aren't as robust as maybe a certain space of time suggests.
Ending on a positive note, relying on the rule of law and technocratic expertise to moderate our impulses. Cass Sunstein, thank you very much.
Thank you.